Welcome everyone joining us for this launch of the 11th EDF project on sanitary and phytosanitary measures, modernizing agricultural health and food safety systems in CARIFORUM states for improved regional and international trade. I am pleased to welcome and acknowledge our ICA Director General, Manuel Otero, Mr. Felipe de la Mota, and the team from the EU delegation here in Barbados, Ambassador Joseph Cox, Assistant Secretary General, Trade and Economic Integration from the CARICOM Secretariat, Mr. Milton Horton, Executive Director, CARICOM Regional Fisheries Mechanism, Mr. Simeon Collins, the CEO of CAFSA, the Caribbean Agricultural Health and Food Safety Agency, all of our development partners, Caribbean Development Bank, CrossQ, CARDI, the OECS Commission, CARFA, and many others. While the COVID pandemic has necessitated some adjustments to the project schedule and operating arrangements, we now have the unique opportunity through this virtual launch to welcome a wide hemispheric regional and regional audience. And in this context, I'm pleased to acknowledge the presence of ministers of agriculture in the region. We have Honorable Michael Pintard of Bahamas, Honorable Ezekiel Joseph from St. Lucia, Honorable Horsford Bain and her team from Grenada, and all of the representatives of the Ministries of Agriculture and Food Safety Regulation agencies. Let me also welcome our featured speaker, Ms. Gretchen Stanton, an international expert on trade and AHSF issues. I would also like to welcome our ICA colleagues and stakeholders joining us from our five regions. And last, but certainly not least, I would also like to specially acknowledge the presence of the media. Communication and visibility are very important in this project, and the role of the media in informing our stakeholders of developments and impacts of the project at national and regional and international levels is critical to success and sustainability of our actions. We have a packed program this morning, and without any further ado, I would like to welcome our Director General, Manuel Otero, to bring welcome remarks on behalf of ICA. Director General, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ina. Good morning, everyone. I would like to recognize, first of all, the Honorable Ministers of Bahamas, Michael Pintard, from St. Lucia, Honorable Ezekiel Joseph, and Minister from Grenada, Honorable Yolande Brain Horsford. I would like also recognize Mr. Felipe de la Mota from European Union, a unique partner of FICA, and on his behalf, I would like to recognize other partner from ICA, CARIFORUM Directorate, CARICOM Secretariat, the Caribbean Regional Fisheries Mechanism, and Caribbean Agriculture Health and Food Safety Agency to implement the 11th EDF Sanitary and Phytosanitary Measures Project. This project, as Ina mentioned, seeks to increase compliance by CARIFORUM states with international SPS measures, standards, and procedures so as to increase international and regional market access. This project builds on the 10th EDF SPS project, which made significant progress to strengthen agricultural health and food safety systems in CARIFORUM countries. To highlight a few achievements under the previous project, in the area of legislation, for example, model bills, protocols, measures, and guidelines in the areas of plant and animal health, food safety, and fisheries. All of them were developed to assist countries to update and harmonize the existing legislative framework in the region. Also, we improved coordination across ministries and agencies responsible for SPS controls. Last but not least, regarding capacity building, Over 2,000 regulatory personnel and private sector stakeholders were strengthened in important SPS areas. 27 private sector received direct technical assistance, and over 50 knowledge products were developed on key topics. This capacity built contributed towards developing a strong cadre of technical personnel to support an effective and efficient regime for agriculture and fisheries, health and food safety. Looking ahead, the current 11th EDF SPS project will further strengthen agriculture health and food safety system of CARICOM countries to comply with SPS measures required by trading partners to ensure the safe trade of agriculture project. This project will therefore contribute to increasing exports and capitalizing on market opportunities globally, in particular those resulting from CARIFORUM EU Economic Partnership Agreement. Currently, while southern countries like Brazil or Chile get $8 for every dollar spent from imports, some Eastern Caribbean countries, as an average, get just 3 cents for every dollar spent from imports. In the context of the crisis caused by pandemia, ICA strongly believes in the necessity of promoting smart agriculture, but not just the climate smart agriculture, but also a nutrition smart agriculture, providing safe food to local, regional, and global markets through the application of appropriate SPS measures, and in which digital technology will play a key role. The new project fits into ICA's wider agriculture health, safety, and food quality program, through which we conduct actions in the hemisphere to modernize plant health services, support development, implementation, and harmonization of science-based plant health, animal health, food safety, and food quality standards, and promote the use and adoption of good agriculture practices, and strengthen national and regional capacities to deal with emergency issues and sanitary, phytosanitary, and food safety emergency, such as the COVID-19 pandemic. Precisely in response to the pandemic, ICA developed several capacity building tools to support the agricultural health and food safety needs of member states. Short-term actions taken include the development of protocols and guides for emergency management, sharing experiences and good practices, and the review of protocols and harmonization of AHFC, FS requirements. Medium-term actions comprise online programs on good agriculture practices design, and as well as food inspection and general accreditation principles. The wide variety of actions of ICA's technical cooperation in agriculture health and food safety, as well as those being implemented under the new project, will ultimately assist with enhancing competitiveness and increased market access in regional and international markets. Additionally, these actions will assist with regional harmonization of SPS measures, which are critical for advancing the CARICOM single market and economy, attaining current food and nutrition security goals of the region. We at ICA are pleased to serve as the executing agency for the 11th EDF SPS project. We will honor the trust deposited on us by the European Union and CARIFORUM countries. And also, let me reinforce our commitment to ensuring its successful implementation in such a way that the project outputs and outcomes will contribute to the integration of the Caribbean Forum of the ACP Group of States into the world economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Manuel Otero, ECA Director General, for setting the context for the implementation of the 11th EDF follow-on SPS project. Felipe de la Bota is the team leader, cooperation, integration of the delegation of the European Union representing Barbados, the Eastern Caribbean states, the OECS, and CARICOM Tariff Forum. During the implementation of the 10th EDF SPS project, we received invaluable support, guidance, and encouragement from his team, and notably from Katja Svensson. And we achieved all the successes Manuel also mentioned. The support has continued with the development of the follow-on SPS project under the EDF. Please have you come, Felipe de la Bota, for the bring remarks from the EDF.
Thank you, Ina, and good morning to all participants in this launch, and particular acknowledgments to Director General Otero, Honorable Ministers and Representatives from the Member States, regional organizations, implementing agencies, and the rest of stakeholders. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today on behalf of the EU and the Delegation Barbados in particular. As you know, the 11th EDF Sanitary and Phytosanitary Measures Project, the SPS project for short, is an important component of a larger EU-funded program that aims to support CARIFORUM member states in the implementation of commitments under the European Partnership Agreement, the EPA. To benefit Felipe, fully from...
Felipe,
yes, can you hear me?
Yes, we are having some problems. We can't not hear you, so... Could you please review your equipment and your microphone
can you hear me now?
Starting again?
Yes, can you hear me now?
Okay. Can you hear me now? No, no.
Now, can you hear me?
No, what we can do now is maybe if you can check and review your equipment, and Ina, maybe we can continue with the next presenter and to give some time to Felipe to review his internet signal and his equipment. Ina, go ahead.
Thank you. I understand that my introduction also was a little bit distorted, so Felipe, I'll introduce you properly when we continue. I'd like to move on, and then we'll come back to the EU to introduce the CARIFORUM Directorate. The CARIFORUM Directorate, represented here today by Ms. Karen Dani Kunja, is the overall manager for the implementation of the 11 EDF projects under the EPA, of which the SPS project is one component. So please let me welcome Karen and Kunja to bring remarks from the CARIFORUM Directorate. Karen, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ina. Good morning, everyone. Special good morning to your Director General and honorable ministers attending. I'd like to say that the DG was expected to join this meeting this morning. I'm not sure what has happened, whether there was some connectivity problem. We were experiencing some difficulties with the internet. And so I'm not prepared at this moment to give the remarks I would have liked to give. But I'd like to say that this is a very important project for CARIFORUM. And it is one of the six components on the wider EPA support program. And it contributes significantly to the EPA implementation. Not only for the EPA implementation, it cuts across several areas, including food security, as was mentioned by our Director General. Director General and colleagues, CARIFORUM is honored to be a part of this undertaking. And together with the EU, this is one of the flagship programs being implemented under the 11th EDF CRIP. It is of a significant value of over 21 million euros. And the intervention is very timely, especially now with this COVID-19 situation. The region is in need more and more during this time for the SPS measures to be put in place, for us to build our key partnerships with the various implementing institutions and other key stakeholders. We also are significantly pressed with not only the COVID-19 situation, but we have other things the region is dealing with, including political situation. And we are mindful of these, but as we undertake to go ahead with the implementation, we'd like to encourage all of the stakeholders. We are also grateful for having ICA as a partner with us under this 11th EDF program, continuing from the 10th, having had some good results under the 10th, which laid the foundation for this new intervention. Together, we can see this program adding value along with a number of other key programs, including the CSME. We also have flagship programs which are being implemented by the Caribbean Export Development Agency. We have programs being implemented by our partners in the Dominican Republic. And we have programs being implemented by SIDEMA, some other key national and regional institutions, including the International Trade Center. We have partnerships now with PAHO as well. So together we can do a lot. There's so much complementarity as well and synergies with not only the various components under the IPA program, but all of these other programs cutting across the three thematic areas of the 11th EDF regional program. So CARIFORM is very pleased, and on behalf of the Director General, as well as our Secretary General, we wish everyone success, and we do hope for strengthening of the partnership and collaboration, and expect that the results will be achieved and gained even better this time round. So thank you very much, colleagues, and all the best with the implementation.
Thank you, Karen Danikunja from the CARIFORM Secretariat. Felipe, okay, and I will go on CARIFORM and then come back to you. I'm sorry, the CARIFORM Secretariat is another key partner in the implementation of this SPS project and a key partner for ICA also in all that we do in the Caribbean region. And it is only fitting that the Assistant Secretary General, Ambassador Joseph Cox, representing trade and economic integration, will address us today at this launch of the 11th EDF SPS project. Mr. Cox, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Dr. Otero, Director General of ICA, honorable ministers of government, members of the private sector, my colleagues from CARIFORM, CRFM, CAFSA, and of course, acknowledging the presence of the EU delegation in these proceedings, and members of our media, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, all good morning. Now, first of all, let me use the opportunity to convey our profound regrets on behalf of the Secretary General, who was unable to attend this important launch this morning due to conflicts in the schedule. Now, the Secretariat is extremely pleased to be associated with the launch of this SPS component of the 11th European Development Fund Program support the CARIFORM states. Now, this project launch is intended to highlight the potential contribution of the project towards strengthening the capacity of CARIFORM states to comply with SPS requirements in regional and international markets. At the heart of this project is the facilitation of agricultural trade, both intra-regionally and extra-regionally. Madam Chair, as in any project, unpredictable situations will arise. As is common knowledge, the COVID-19 has adversely affected our regional agriculture sector, and indeed, and its impact has really impacted all our economies. Planners, programmers, and policymakers are beginning to factor in COVID-19 and its impact on as part of the new normal, and the Secretariat is very pleased to note the painstaking efforts that are therefore being taken in mitigating this risk with respect to project implementation and work plan and budget for year one, which is slated to run from February 2020 to January 2021. I'm happy to report that very early in the process, the CARICOM Secretariat has acted decisively in mobilizing stakeholders in the region in responding to the threats in a coordinated manner, and emerging from this process was the COVID-19 Food Security Task Force, and subsequently our CARICOM COVID-19 Agri-Food Action Plan, which was prepared by the Secretariat in collaboration with our regional partner organizations. This document outlines the pertinent interventions in the form of an action plan of activities to be undertaken by regional organizations and member states to treat with the immediate fallout from the COVID-19 pandemic and to strengthen the food and national security, nutritional security in the ensuing years. Many of these interventions speak explicitly to SPS issues being addressed by this project and promotes the close alignment with the CARICOM COVID-19 Agri-Food Action Plan. The final report of the implementation of the 10th EDF SPS project states that a persistent challenge of development projects is ensuring that the benefits of interventions are sustained after the project ends. This is a timely reminder as we prepare to launch the 11th EDF SPS project. The end of this project must not find us thinking that we did not do enough to sustain all of the positive effects so prominently identified in the project. In this regard, the CARICOM Secretariat is fully supportive of actions during the early stages of implementation that provide opportunities and utilize existing fora, such as the quoted meetings, meetings of industry associations, and the like, of the importance and relevance of the SPS issues to development of the countries and the region. Additionally, promotion of stakeholder engagement and collaboration and coordination with national, regional, and international, such as CAFSA, FAO, and others, will go a far way in promoting continuity of the actions in their individual work programs. Now, this SPS measures project is crucial for increasing the capacity for exports and, by extension, increased economic development for our region. The CARICOM Secretariat continues to be committed in promoting and facilitating increased SPS compliance and agricultural health and food safety standards, and works closely with the CAFSA in this regard. We are willing and committed to shouldering more than our fair share in ensuring the success of this project, and therefore do not take lightly our representation on the 11th EDF SPS Technical Advisory Committee. With that, Madam Chair, please accept the Secretariat's best wishes as we launch this very critical 11th SPS project. And with that, I thank you.
Thank you so much, Ambassador Cox. We are indeed pleased and reassured of CARICOM's commitment and support of the emergency food plan that is being implemented with all of our ministries of agriculture. Food quality, food availability, accessibility to food, and food safety of critical importance. When COVID hit, nobody went out to buy gold and all of those other things. They went out to buy food and secure their health. So we are acutely aware of the critical importance of this project and of CARICOM's commitment and support for all that we do in the region. Thanks again, Ambassador Cox. Under the 10th EDF, the Caribbean Regional Fisheries Mechanism collaborate with the EDF successfully implement all SPS projects. And under this EDF-SPS project, CRM will be responsible once more for leading the coordination, technical supervision, and implementation of the fisheries activities of the project. I now welcome Milton Horton, CEO of CRFM, to bring us remarks from the CRFM. Milton, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson, Honorable Ministers, Director General of AICA, Assistant Secretary General of CARICOM, Representative of the European Union, CEO of CAFSA, distinguished representatives of member states, partnering agencies, and the private sector. Ladies and gentlemen, a pleasant good morning to you. On behalf of the Caribbean Regional Fisheries Mechanism, I extend a very warm welcome to all of you who have joined us this morning to launch this project. We are very pleased to be partnering in this important initiative. I take this opportunity to thank the EU for their contribution and support for this important project aimed at supporting the region's development and integration in the world economy. Our countries are all highly dependent on international trade for economic growth, particularly the inflows of foreign exchange from the export of our agricultural products and marine resources. Export of fish and fishery products from CARIFORUM countries is valued at between $300 to $400 million United States dollars each year. Although fish and seafood have long been traded internationally, trade has increased dramatically in recent decades, such that fish and fishery products now constitute the most highly traded food commodity internationally. The value of international trade of fish increased from $15 billion United States dollars in 1980 to nearly $150 billion today, according to FAO. The level of trade has been growing at an accelerating pace in recent years in response to increased demand and rising production, particularly from aquaculture. This 11th EDF-supported SPS project is relatively small in its funding commitment, but it is nevertheless a very important and timely initiative that will help the CARIFORUM states to modernize their agricultural health and food safety systems for improved regional and international trade in agricultural and fisheries products. It will consolidate and build upon previous investments made in the agricultural and fisheries sector under the 10th EDF-SPS project and advance the state of SPS compliance in the region. With the recent focus on achieving the Sustainable Development Goals and promoting blue economic growth, there has been increased attention on the tremendous potential of the marine and fisheries resources in the waters around us to contribute to food security, trade, and resilient, sustainable economic growth and development in our countries. Our fisheries and marine resources, including aquaculture, are very important for food and nutrition security, trade, and livelihoods of thousands of families and small businesses across the region. But to realize the Sustainable Development Goals, we must establish and implement the enabling environment, the policies and legislations, institutions and governance reforms based on sound evidence-based approaches that take into account the three dimensions of sustainability: economic, social, and environmental. The recent challenges we have been facing in the region arising from the COVID-19 pandemic, the massive blooms and influx of sargassum seaweed in our waters with elevated levels of heavy metals such as arsenic and cadmium, and the ongoing and increasing threats to our marine ecosystems and our countries from warming waters, sea level rise, and ocean acidification add urgency to the need for action to reinforce our governance systems. This is why this particular initiative that we are launching this morning to strengthen SPS systems, enhance competitiveness, increase market access, and ultimately expand trade and economic growth and resilience of our countries is so important for us. We at the Caribbean Regional Fisheries Mechanism look forward with much enthusiasm to working together with all our partners and stakeholders in the public and private sectors to implement this important action over the next 3 years, and to do so with a sense of urgency for the benefit of our people and our countries. Madam Chair, thank you very much, and God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Milton, for your very honest and comprehensive remarks about the fisheries sector and the importance of this project. I'm now going to bring back in the EU representative Felipe de la Mota, and I think when I introduced him earlier, the presentation was a little distorted. Before I do so, however, I just want to say it's so good to see representation from all of our strategic partners, and to let you, for those of us who join us a bit, welcome an introductory remark from the director, and we have remarks now from all of our key partners, key strategic partners in project implementation. This will be followed by an overview of the project and our featured speaker. So I'm now going to ask Felipe de la Mota, who is the leader, team leader for cooperation in regional integration and trade delegation of the European Union, Barbados, Eastern Caribbean States, the OECS, and CARICOM, CARI Forum. So please give us his remarks. I just want to reemphasize that during the implementation of the 10th EDF, Felipe and his team used invaluable support and to acknowledge the support of the Scottish Venison. So please, Felipe, you're welcome to the remarks. I know you may not be justified, but we want to hear your remarks from the EU delegation. Floor is yours.
Thank you, Ina. Let's try again. I've got my cell phone now. You have to be prepared these days, I guess. So let's give it another go. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you can hear me well?
Go ahead. All right, this works then.
Yes.
Great.
Go ahead.
Okay, well, thank you again. And good morning to all participants in the launch, and particularly to Director General Otero, honorable ministers and representatives from the member states, regional organizations, implementing agencies, and the rest of stakeholders. Thanks a lot for being here. And for me, it's a pleasure to be in this launch today representing the European Union. As been mentioned before, but I just want to reiterate, the SPS project, this 11th EDF project, is an important component of a larger EU-funded program that aims to support CARIFORUM member states in the implementation of commitments undertaken under the Economic Partnership Agreement, the EPA. Now, in order to benefit fully from this EPA signed with the EU and engage in international and regional trade, the Caribbean region must comply with SPS standards, since SPS compliance is part and parcel of a modern agricultural and food safety system. But going beyond just trade, food safety is a crucial aspect of all regional food systems. Building capacity on good agricultural practices, traceability, combating antimicrobial resistance are all global issues, and we're very happy to lend our support to CARIFORUM member states in this important endeavor. As you know, the EU has recently launched the European Green Deal, where we have the ambition to achieve a climate neutral EU by 2050. Sustainable food systems, or as we've called it, from farm to fork, is a very important cornerstone of this Green Deal. We aim to create food systems that are healthy for us and for the planet. So in short, we're focusing on healthy, affordable, and nutritious food for EU citizens, tackling climate change, protecting the environment and biodiversity, fair economic return in the food chain, and increasing organic farming. Now, related to this is also, of course, stemming food waste, a tremendous problem at both producer and consumer levels, ensuring correct food labeling, and also working with our partners like CARIFORUM to promote a global move to sustainable food systems. Now, as Ina mentioned, this project builds on the 10th EDF project. Building capacity on food safety is a process. We see it this way: targeting the legal, regulatory environment, building coordination, stakeholder networks covering the whole food supply chain, as well as building capacity on food safety for farms and fisheries and producers and retailers. And let's not forget educating the consumers on their right to food safety. Change can come about far quicker if there's a demand from consumers for healthy and sustainable produced food. Finally, maybe a few words on the very unusual circumstances we're all living since the outbreak of coronavirus. It's clearly placed the spotlight on the fragility of our way of life, on the unsustainable consumption patterns we've had, and the weaknesses in the regional and global supply systems, food being one of the most important for sure. It's also given us, though, some time to reflect. I mean, the great lockdown can be considered a natural experiment that I believe is going to feed PhDs of social disciplines for generations. So we've yet a lot to learn on the impact this will have. But in this context, the Caribbean region has decided that the challenges presented by this virus will be impetus for promoting food security through domestic agriculture production, as well as inter-regional trade. And we in the EU, as you know, are doing the same. So let us make sure we learn from each other as we move forward with sustainability, affordability, and equity at the core of our support to the region's food systems. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Felipe. Excellent remarks and interesting take on COVID and how we reimagine our future post-COVID. For me, I think it will be a time of innovation and a one world view. I now move on to introduce our next speaker.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairperson.
Mr. Simeon Collins, the CEO of CAFSA. As an intergovernmental organization among member states of the Caribbean community, CAFSA performs a coordinating and organizing role in establishing an effective and efficient regional sanitary and phytosanitary regime. Mr. Collins, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairperson. With protocol already established, let me say bonjour. Udamaka, buenos dias, and good morning to everyone. On behalf of the Board of Directors, management, and staff of the Caribbean Agricultural Health and Food Safety Agency, CAFSA, would like to express our sincere gratitude to ICA and the EDF for agreeing to facilitate the development of a regional policy and action plan for agricultural health and food safety under the 11th EDF project. As you may be aware, CAFSA was established about 6 years ago by the heads of government of the Caribbean community, CARICOM, to assist member states to meet their obligations under the WTO SPS agreement and by extension, the revised Treaty of Chagaramas, which establishes the CARICOM single market and economy. Our main areas of focus are, as our name indicates, agricultural health, that's plant health and animal health. And in addition to that, food safety. Over the last 6 years, despite tremendous human resource and financial challenges, satisfactory progress was made in our effort to modernize agricultural health and food safety systems in CARICOM member states. For instance, in the area of regional and international collaboration, we have sought and received observer status to the meetings of the OIE, the IPPC, Codex Alimentarius Commission, and the WTO SPS Committee. We have also signed a practical arrangement with the International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA, in an effort to coordinate the use of nuclear technology for application in agriculture in member states. And MOU was also signed with CrossQ and CRFM. In the area of animal health, a regional procedure for trade in animals and animal products was developed, as well as a draft CARICOM policy on importation of animal and animal products. Additionally, there is assessment for pork and pork products to be traded intra-regionally were conducted, resulting in the approval of 9 companies from 6 member states to export pork and poultry products throughout the region. In the area of plant health, guidelines for conducting pest risk analysis have been developed to provide a standardized model for interpreting and applying international standards for pest risk analysis. Additionally, a guideline for preparing market access proposals have been prepared by CAFSA and approved for use by the COTEP. In addition, CAFSA was recognized by the Commission of Phytosanitary Measures as the Regional Plant Protection Organization of the Caribbean, the RPPO of the Caribbean. 10 fact sheets and CARICOM regulated pests were developed, as well as data sheets for 15 pests that impact nursery production in Dominica as part of an LOA with the FAO. We also completed the provision of services towards strengthening the plant and animal quarantine capacities of 3 member states, St. Kitts and Nevis, Grenada, and Dominica, through our LOA with the FAO. Through another LOA with the FAO, a technical working group was formed to assist CARICOM member states and associate members in meeting their obligations under the IPPC. Technical support in capacity building for monitoring and surveillance for 2 insect pests of quarantine importance in Grenada was also provided through our LOA with the FAO. In the area of food safety, a standard was developed with funding from the 10th EDF SPS project for cassava flour, and cassava flour to be traded regionally was evaluated as a first step towards some level of standardization of the product in the region. Additionally, a workshop on regional food safety standards coordination targeted at food safety regulators of all 15 member states was conducted with assistance from the FAO. As a result of this workshop, the COTED endorsed the creation of a Caribbean Task Force on Food Safety to act as an advisory body to CAFSA on food safety matters. Regional biosafety policy developed by UWE was approved by the COTED, and a draft regional model biosafety bill was completed with the assistance of a consultant. It is important to know that CAFSA is now the regional biosafety clearinghouse for CARICOM member states. In the area of pesticides, COTED has endorsed the hosting of the Secretariat of the Coordinating Group of Pesticide Control Boards of the Caribbean at CAFSA's headquarters in Suriname. And support to CAFSA was provided through an LOA with the FAO to pilot a technical working group for pesticide registration evaluation for all member states. Several databases related to agricultural health and food safety was developed to improve the delivery and sharing of information across the region, and a draft procedure for encouraging and facilitating the resolution of specific agricultural health and food safety issues among member states was developed. I should also add that CAFSA partnered with the WTO, the CARICOM Secretariat, and the OECS Commission to facilitate a WTO regional workshop on the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement aimed at supporting strategic and effective implementation in CARICOM. Finally, as part of the CARICOM COVID-19 Action Plan and through assistance from the CDB, CAFSA is expected to undertake the development of SPS commodity specific guidelines for at least 15 agricultural produce submitted by member states to be traded intra-regionally so as to increase and facilitate the safe trade in agricultural produce of importance in the region. This, in a nutshell, are some of the areas that we have been involved in over the past 5 years. We are therefore happy that the 11th EDF SPS project has agreed to fund the development of an agricultural health and food safety policy for the region. The intention of this activity is to develop a harmonized regional agricultural health and food safety policy and action plan for the Caribbean that would provide member states and regional community institutions with the support they need to address agricultural health and food safety in a focused and targeted manner, and which we hope will clarify the roles of the multi-agencies in the region which are involved in agricultural health and food safety. To conclude, I am scheduled to this on September 30th. It's in about 3 months' time. So let me say that I have enjoyed working with all of you over the past 5 to 6 years. And let me take the opportunity to wish all of you the best in your future endeavors. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. And let me, on behalf of everyone in the meeting, thank you for your commitment and your service and for the excellent work that you've been able to achieve with your leadership with CAFSA. I'm sure that with this project, we will achieve our regional policy for food safety across the region. And as we move from this section of the agenda, I'm sure that everyone in the meeting will agree with me that we have a solid and awesome network of partners with whom we can develop the synergies and actions needed for this region to satisfy not only its domestic and regional food safety requirements, perhaps even importantly, in the context of sustaining livelihoods, to facilitate our successful participation with four high quality, certified and accredited products. So thank you, Mr. Collins, and thanks to all our partners for your excellent remarks and look into the description of the actual project. And it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Janet Lawrence, our ECA Hemispheric Specialist in Agricultural Health and Food Safety and the Project Manager for the SPS project. Dr. Lawrence brings a depth and a wealth of experience in both technical and administrative aspects of this EU project, as well as a keen understanding of the Caribbean people and the region. She brings a high level of professionalism and commitment to her work. And we're very happy to have her back as part of the ECA family. I want to take this opportunity also to give a shout out to Carol Thomas, who has joined our launch. Carol and Jan were a formidable team under the 10th EDF SPS project, and their hard work and commitment resulted in all of the successes, together, of course, with the collaboration. So I now invite Dr. Janet Lawrence to give an overview of the project. Jan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you very much for your extremely kind words. Director General of ECA, Dr. Manuel Otero, our representatives from our partner institutions, such as the CARIFORUM Directorate, the European Union, the CARICOM Secretariat, our co-implementing partner from the CRFM, CAFSA, and our special guest speaker, Ms. Gretchen Stanton of the WTO, former senior counselor. Our partners, our stakeholders within the agricultural health and food safety fraternity, media, and of course, my fellow colleagues from ECA. Good morning to all. It is indeed my pleasure to have been asked to give an overview, a brief overview of this 11th EDF SPS project. And what I will do is provide just a little context around the project and then move on to the objectives. What are we doing? What are the main actions, the benefits, and how we intend to roll out the project. Now, as been said so many times this morning, we are facing significant challenges in the region with respect to our ability to comply with international SPS standards for trade in agriculture and fisheries products. And what this has resulted in is that there has been reduced access to global and regional markets. And a number of constraints have been identified. And the three main ones have really been the outdated legislation, the lack of coordination across multiple jurisdictions responsible for SPS controls, and limited human capacity in terms of public and private sector. And we know over the years, there have been several interventions to alleviate these constraints, both nationally and regionally. But as the requirements of trading partners evolve based on the demands that they are having from consumers, we within the Caribbean region need to work continuously to ensure that we strengthen our agricultural health and food safety programs. And so therefore, it is a system that evolves, it's a system that is dynamic, which we constantly have to be strengthening. Under the 10th EDF, we were able to achieve significant advances in these three areas that I've highlighted. We were able to develop a series of model bills to strengthen and harmonize the legislative framework, to develop mechanisms to help countries with proper coordination of SPS controls. And we were able to train more than 2,000 public and private sector stakeholders in some key areas of agricultural health and food safety. And as such, this current project builds on the advances made under the 10th and therefore seeks to increase the compliance of CARIFORUM states with international SPS measures, standards, and procedures to increase our international and regional market access. The project is valued at 1.25 million euros and has a duration of 36 months. The first 6 months of the project is a pre-implementation phase, and we are still in that phase now until the end of this month. And then 30 months will be rolling out on the ground technically. Now, who benefits? The public and private sector. For the public sector, persons involved in the regulatory and inspection services, the competent authorities that are involved in the coordination. In private sector, stakeholders from selected value chains and targeting mainly small and medium-sized operators. As has been said before, targets the 15 CARIFORUM countries. Now the project has three major components. The first component looks at the strengthening of the SPS regulatory framework. The second looks at SPS compliance through capacity building. And the third looks at strengthening SPS capacity in the fisheries subsector. And the third component is implemented by our partners, the CRFM. Now, what are some of the specific actions on each of these components? For component one, which looks at the regulatory environment, Mr. Collins spoke to the issue of a regional agricultural health and food safety policy. This was a recommendation coming out of the 10th EDF and something that was strongly felt that it was necessary for us as a region to have. As a result, the Agricultural Health and Food Safety Cluster, which is led by CAFSA, requested that this be a critical action under the project. And what we hope from having a policy, which as you know, undergirds any sort of regional framework that we need to have, we will have a more coherent and focused and coordinated approach as it relates to agricultural health and food safety issues within the region. The second activity looks at upgrading national regulatory framework in select countries. Under the 10th EDF, we would have developed model bills in the areas of plant health, animal health, food safety, and fisheries. And some countries have already started utilizing these model bills to upgrade their legislation, but there are still a number of countries that need assistance in this area. And so we will be assisting some select countries. And of course, as you know, the legislative framework, having an updated and modernized legislative framework is critical for us to be able to have market access. The third aspect, the third activity, looks at the promotion of the implementation of national coordination mechanisms. Under the previous project, 10 countries were assisted to develop national coordinating mechanisms. And so what we would like to do is to go back to these countries to determine what are the factors limiting the effective implementation of efficient coordination mechanisms, and working with the countries to determine how we can alleviate these constraints through the implementation of several capacity building exercises. Now, if we move on to component number two, our largest activity under component number two is building the capacity of SMEs with respect to their food safety standards. We are targeting three value chains that are of significance and importance to the region, not only for food and nutrition security, but also for trade. And the three value chains are coconut, spices and condiments, and roots and tubers. And so in these select companies, we will go in and provide technical assistance, which would include training and technical guidelines, giving persons recommendations and helping them to be able to meet some certification or food safety mark that would improve their ability to enter into an international market. On the component two, we will also have a series of capacity building exercises, training workshops and seminars, and at this point virtually, given the backdrop of the COVID crisis. And we will be conducting these capacity building exercises in some of the key areas such as HACCP, gap auditing, and antimicrobial resistance. These were key areas that were identified by countries at the beginning of last year as being critical for them in terms of improving their ability to meet standards. Last but not least, and very importantly, the upgrading of laboratories to conduct tests required for market access. Many of our labs are not able to provide the testing capabilities to provide exporters with a service that allows them to conduct the tests required to enter certain markets. And so we will be working with a few labs to upgrade them in this area. The last component, as I said, is being developed by the CRFM. And there are three activities under component three. The first looks at the development of an implementation plan to strengthen the regional coordination framework for fisheries and aquaculture. Now, this is a very important activity. Under the 10th EDF, a green paper was developed that proposed this regional framework. And therefore, what will happen here is that we will be developing this implementation plan of how to cooperate within the fisheries and aquaculture sector so that there is improved management and monitoring of SPS controls within this area. Secondly, there will be building of capacity of the private sector in terms of SPS requirements, good fish and fishery hygiene practices. Under the last project, there were several technical tools developed, manuals, bulletins, and videos. And these will be used to train persons in processing factories so that they can meet the required international standards, the mark, to enable them to export. Lastly, also the upgrading of testing laboratories in the areas of residue and monitoring, environmental monitoring. This is very important in terms of certifying the quality of fish and fish products that need to be exported. So that is, in a nutshell, the activities that will be conducted. And it is our hope that from these activities, we will have an increased capacity for export. We will therefore have improved our ability to comply with SPS requirements and be able to enter international markets, increase our trade, and then, of course, we can see with increased trade some level of economic development. Now, we are conscious and are aware that that these actions that we are conducting are complementary to many ongoing activities that are being conducted by many of our partners. And hence, we will seek to collaborate with these entities to ensure that synergies can be created where they can, and we can increase the impact of the interventions under the project. So some of the regional complementarities and potential synergies can be created from other projects under the 11th EDF, such as the Technical Barriers to Trade project, which is the executing agency being PTB, with the implementing agencies in the region being CrossQ and Indical. The standby facility, which is being executed by the Caribbean Development Bank, and also the coconut development expansion project, which is being conducted or implemented rather by CARDI and the ITC. And of course, CAFSA as the Regional Agricultural Health and Food Safety Coordinating Body being a key partner with us as we move forward. Now, how do we roll out the project? Being a part of the 11th EDF program, we are a member of the Project Steering Committee that is led by the CARIFORUM Directorate. In addition, there is a Technical Advisory Committee. And this Technical Advisory Committee of the project successfully met yesterday and approved the work plan for year one. This committee has representatives from public and private sector, many of the institutions involved in agricultural health and food safety, as well as we have regional private sector organizations such as CABO and the Caribbean Network of Fisher Folk. And we're very pleased to have the private sector on board. The project management unit will be the ECA Barbados unit, and the ECA offices across the region. As you know, we have a great network of offices across the CARIFORUM countries. They will also provide some administrative and logistical support, as well as technical support, because we have a strong cadre of technical specialists that will assist with the implementation. In addition, under the last project, we had a series of teams on the ground, technical national implementation teams, which consisted of public and private sector, and they allowed us to understand a lot of what was happening on the ground, and we had continuous communication through the ECA offices with these teams. And so we look forward to re-engaging these teams as we fully implement the project. So, ladies and gentlemen, in a nutshell, that is what we will be doing over the next 30 months in terms of the implementation of the SPS project. It is an extremely important project for the region. And we know that with the successful implementation of this project, we will be contributing to the attainment of CARICOM, food and nutrition security goals, sustained trade and economic development. And in addition, we will be contributing to the integration of CARIFORUM states into the world economy. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention. And Madam Chair, I hand it back to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for such an explicit and easily understood presentation, very clear as usual. And thanks again for your excellent presentation. It is now my pleasure and honor to introduce our featured speaker. Gretchen Stanton was born in Sinaloa, Mexico, and emigrated to the US at a young age. She received a bachelor's degree in economics and Latin American studies and a master's degree in agricultural economics from the University of Arizona. She worked for the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Foreign Agricultural Service, FAS, in Washington, D.C., and in Mexico City as a U.S. agricultural attaché. In 1985, she joined the Agriculture and Commodities Division of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, GATT, in Geneva, Switzerland, which subsequently became the World Trade Organization. From 1989 to 1995, she served as chairperson of the working group, negotiating the agreement on the application of sanitary and phytosanitary measures, and was secretary of the SPS committee from 1995 until 2015. As a senior counselor and the deputy director of the agriculture division of the WTO, she was head of the unit responsible for the implementation of the SPS agreement, including oversight of the Standards and Trade Development Facility, the SCDF, and liaison with other relevant international organizations, including the Codex, OIE, IPPC, the World Bank, and the WHO. During her 31-year career with the GATT WTO, she assisted numerous trade dispute panels considering issues related to agricultural trade and SPS measures, and provided many training workshops and seminars around the globe. Following her retirement from the WTO in 2016, Gretchen has participated in several WTO training activities related to the SPS and TBT arrangements. She is a member of ICA's Hemispheric Program Advisory Committee. Gretchen has provided SPS-related technical training and expert assistance to Japan's Ministry of Agriculture, Forestry and Fisheries. Gretchen also served as an expert witness in an SPS-related law case for the New Zealand Crown. She currently resides in Portland, Maine. And with that introduction, it is my honor to introduce to the podium our featured speaker, Gretchen Stanton. Gretchen, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Dr. Otero, and good morning, or I guess midday, to very distinguished representatives. It's very impressive to see the many different agencies and institutions that are participating in this virtual conference today. Whether it be CARICOM, CARE Forum, the European Union, CAFSA, CRFM, there's a long list and I'm going to miss many of you. But I do want to welcome all of you and thank you for inviting me to address you with a few words today. And where I really want to start is say congratulations. Frankly, looking at the progress that has been made in the SPS area, and the Caribbean region is incredibly impressive. You referred to the fisheries being union group being 5 or 6 years old, and yet how much have you managed to accomplish in such a short period of time? How much has been done with the CAFSA, with the CARICOM, with CARE Forum? It's really very, very impressive to see how in this region, you, many, many of you, have recognized the importance of building capacity in this area and taken so many steps to move forward. Unfortunately, as Dr. Lawrence made very clear, you can't rest on your laurels. This is an ever-evolving area. The standards, requirements get higher and higher every year. If you want to meet market standards, you must constantly be evolving, improving what you are doing, identifying where you still have some shortcomings, and concentrating on getting those addressed, and hopefully getting a little bit ahead of the game as well. It's clear that there are many, many constraints in improving capacity in the SPS area, whether you're targeting your foreign trade markets, whether you're targeting your domestic markets, whether you're targeting the all-important tourism sector for the region, there are many constraints. Some of those constraints are ones that this area you may not be able to address directly in terms of improved access to improved varieties or technologies or access to credit and high labor costs, but others are directly within your purview and responsibilities, improving the monitoring and the reporting and progress on dealing with any pests and diseases, addressing the still, unfortunately, still rather high incidence of foodborne disease in the region, and very importantly, looking at the issues that are coming out of the degradation of your natural resources, including pollution from fertilizer and pesticide runoffs and invasive species. Normally, what I hear from many of those working in this area is that you're well aware of the problems, but there are so many resource constraints, whether they be constraints of human resources, very frequently financial resource constraints, and perhaps most importantly of all, a lack of political and public interest or priority for this area. And this, it's nice to see with projects of this kind and it coming into the 11th project, there clearly are resources being made available to help address some of these issues. There is much more priority and interest being given to this area of need than in the past. And I think it's extremely important to pay heed to the words of one of those long ago wise politicians, Benjamin Franklin, who said, out of adversity comes opportunity. And obviously the adversity right now, the elephant in the room that we are all dealing with is the COVID-19 pandemic. COVID-19 is a zoonosis. It's an animal-borne disease that is spread to humans. And we have been warned for decades by veterinarians, by the World Health Organization, that the next human pandemic was very likely to be an animal-based disease. And here it is. But it's not going to be the last one. The adversity and the problems that COVID has raised in terms not only of the horrendous human health costs, but also of the economic costs. And for your region, the loss of the tourism and that whole sector, the difficulty of bringing people together for training and moving ahead on many projects. This is the kind of issues one has to be aware of and use as arguments for moving ahead into the future. I had often in my training events heard from participants that their difficulty was getting at the highest levels of government and from the public at large and from the media a recognition of how important it was to build capacity in the whole SPS area. And I used to suggest to them that they would have to make up a hypothetical story of what kind of a crisis would occur in your country or in your region if there were to be such a terrible disease outbreak. You don't have to make up the story. It is there. We are living it. But what you need to do is use this as a way in your future arguments to move ahead. We will get through this pandemic. What we need to do is avoid the next one. What if this particular virus had been one that was being transmitted through foodstuffs? What would that have done to your agricultural food trade? What if it were, instead of a virus that's being transmitted as is, if it were one that wiped out major crops critical in your region? How would you manage that? This is what you need to avoid. But now you have the public awareness, you have the political awareness of how dire the consequences can be as one starts to come out of this pandemic and move into your future actions. Don't forget those arguments. Use them. We need to avoid this happening in future. How do we do it? We need to build up our ability to monitor what's going on with the veterinary and animal health to make sure we don't have a disease coming through. We need to be able to ensure that our crops are going to be safely produced and we're not running a risk of this happening in future. we need to make sure that we're not dealing with a risk that is going to be transmitted through foodstuffs, and that is going to, again, cause major economic as well as health damages. So use this adversity to create opportunity. They are very difficult times. Incomes are down, unemployment is up, people are buying less, governments are having less resources coming in, and yet we need to be moving ahead. One idea, one area you want to consider looking at as you are building your capacity and moving out of this crisis, we hope sooner rather than later, is what is this going to mean for your tourism sector? How are you going to make sure that you can bring back those who were coming to visit and ensure that the products, they're all now have a heightened awareness of safety and health risks. How do you ensure them that you are producing and providing to them products of the highest quality possible? You need to put in place the systems to do that and to demonstrate that that is what you are doing. You may have an opportunity that I'm not sure will ever come again with the cruise industry. They are desperate to get back into business, of course. They love to bring their ships to your ports. And yet, I think economically, the gains are relatively limited because they stay on the ship to eat their free meals three times a day. Can you negotiate? Yes, you want to come in. Let's say you don't provide free lunch while you're in port. Let's encourage your passengers to use our local restaurants to come in and bring more business to our local people. But to do it, you have to have sure that you can guarantee you are providing the highest quality products that are safe and that will meet what the people are interested in doing. As you move ahead with this new step and this new project, it is very encouraging to see the focus on ensuring the public and private involvement and the benefits to all, especially to small businesses and enterprises, that you are looking at how to upgrade your national frameworks, but very importantly, to upgrade the coordination mechanisms, both within countries and across the board, to build that capacity. You want to upgrade labs, but you need to be able to maintain them. A one-time upgrade is only going to be useful for a few years. So again, build on this current environment to create that awareness, to put in place systems that will be sustainable in the long term for specific products, for laboratories, for coordination mechanisms. There is often this initial enthusiasm and everyone will come and participate for the few years, and then suddenly there are fewer and fewer people coming. And if that happens, you lose all that you have been working so hard to gain. So you need to put in place systems that keep that recognition going of the importance of maintaining the capacity, of ever evolving the capacity, of modifying and addressing the new concerns that are coming out, particularly those linked with the changing climate and with environmental concerns and degradation and effects in the regions. Make sure you've got those people in place to understand the importance of keeping that system going, of always looking ahead and not saying, well, we've now done it. We now created this institution. We now have a new framework. We have just modified the legislation. Tomorrow, that may not be enough. And one has to keep constantly modifying and evolving with these new good practices, best practices, on a global scale. You have a region that has proven that you have been able to do so much in a short period of time when you work together in a coordinated fashion. Maintain it. Keep moving forward in that direction. Keep the interest going in that direction. Take advantage of the current adversity and situation we are facing and use it as an opportunity to ensure that everyone remains aware of the importance of your capacity and the need to keep that going into the future. Thank you.
I'm sure if we could all undo our mics and give a grand round of applause for our featured speaker, we would. Gretchen, your words, your advice, I think can only come as a distillation of 31 years of expertise and experience in the arena. You have given us some sobering information, yet pragmatic, realistic, solid recommendations for how we should move forward. I want to thank you for your congratulations to the region. I think they're very harsh on ourselves. Sometimes we are our worst critics, but the Caribbean region has shown over the years that when we do work in a coordinated fashion, they're resilient. And despite all the challenges of climate change and all the trade challenges, like pandemics and everything else, we are resilient people and we'll pull through. So thank you for the reassurance and for your congratulations on our success as people in the region. With respect to I think we need to reimagine this post-COVID. What kind of tourists do we want? What kind of services are we prepared to offer? How do we keep on protecting our people or resources? And how can we maybe retrofit our cruise ships for them to bring cargo intra-regionally as visitors? How do we use this on time to ensure we strengthen our food systems to assist not only our tourism industry, but even more importantly, to make sure that there is food for our people across all of our member states. So thank you for a thought inspiring, sobering, realistic, yet hopeful address. We do have a little bit of time for maybe one or two questions. We have one already in the chat. We have some 90 participants. Let Ina, me again.
Ina.
Welcome.
This is Anna.
Yes, Anna.
Apologies for the interruption, but we are having some problems with
my audio.
Yes, oh, we can hear you. So if you check again your equipment, please. Thank you.
I'm not sure what else to check.
It's better now.
It's better now? Don't move. They're telling me don't move. I'm swinging too much. All right, I'm going to stay. It's better now. I just wanted to start Gretchen.
No, it's happening again.
It's happening again. I'm going to continue because I'm not sure what to check because they checked more things than I checked. I will end one question that is in the chat. What are the best practices and lessons learned from the 10th EDF SPS project? And after that question, I'd ask Dr. Lawrence to address that question. And after that question is answered, we'll have closing remarks by Ana Marisa Cordero, acting head of our HS unit. Dr. John, I hope you heard me. What are the best practices and lessons learned from the 10th EDF SPS project? Please take the floor.
Thanks a lot, Madam Chair. Just to make sure that I would have heard the question properly, so I'll repeat it.
What are the best practices and lessons learned from the 10th EDF? That's it.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for the question. So if we look at the 10th EDF, what are the best practices? What were the best practices? I think one of the best practices that that came out of it was the issue of conducting training at two levels, that in that we would have trained persons who could have been trainer of trainers that now could go and continue the training after the project had completed. And I think that was very critical in terms of sustaining the interventions over time. There were several lessons learned, and so I'm just choosing some of the significant ones. The other area would have been the importance of having excellent visibility and communication in terms of what were the outputs of the project at any one time, so that we would have been able to reach a larger grouping of stakeholders in terms of having access to the information generated and being able to implement. So I think in terms of practices and lessons learned, those would be the two critical things that would have been very important to the success post project.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lawrence. I now invite Ana Marisa Cordero to give us closing remarks for this launch. Ana Marisa, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Ina. I just want to quote our Director General's words and say that ICA is pleased to serve as the executing agency for the 11th EDF SPS project and is committed to ensuring its successful implementation so that the project outputs and outcomes contributes to the integration of the Caribbean Forum into the world economy. Thanks so much to the government authorities that have been here with us today, to our partnering agencies, our main speaker, and to all the ones that have joined us through the social media for their interest and support. We are going through difficult times, but working together, we can overcome and address those constraints. And working together again, we can be able to support the improvement of the SPS infrastructure in the Caribbean region. Thank you so much and keep safe.
And with those remarks, I want to thank the 90 plus participants who have joined us from across the hemisphere. And to thank everyone who participated in this launch. And to once again reassure everyone that we are going to do our very best to ensure that this project is a success, and that we continue to network and work as a coordinated team with all of our partners across the region to bring the Caribbean to world-class performance. Thank you, everyone. Have a good day and keep safe and keep well. Over and out.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
And bye.
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 Have a good day, everyone.
Goodbye, everybody, and best wishes. Look forward to working with everybody in the coming months and years to implement this and make it a good success. Thank you.
Excellent. We're looking forward to that too, Milton. Thank you for coming and thank you for your continued support.
All the best, everyone.
Thank you, Karen.
Thank you, Karen.
Bye,
excellent.
Everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Katia. Thanks for coming.
Thanks, Katia.
Excellent launch, everyone. Congrats. Yes, congrats to the team.
Thank you. So good to see you. So good to hear you.
Best.
Congratulations for a good launch.
Thanks, Beverly. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, hey, welcome. Carol.